This is the Kia Stonic. It's Kia's smallest SUV that they make, and apparently it is very Insta-worthy. The Kia Stonic range starts off from $23,490, but this one here is the GT line, so this one is priced from $30,490. I'm here to tell you whether this is going to be a good first car or a good little inner city SUV. I'll walk you around the outside, on the inside, and we'll take it for a drive, and more importantly, I'll tell you if you should buy one. My name's Cameron, this is Product Review Cars. Let's get into it. I actually think this Stonic looks quite sporty and quite interesting, and that's probably helped by how many vents are here up front at the front of the Stonic. It still has the old Kia badge, the new one is coming. And along here, we also have this quad LED daytime running light design. These are nice bright LEDs, and I do think the front looks nice and aggressive. However, for some, it might look a little bit busy for them. Around side, we have 18-inch alloy wheels, which are dual tone, and they do suit this car quite well. I think a lot better than the standard rims that you get lower down. So that's a big plus if you go up the range. Also, plenty of plastic cladding here along the side, which is obviously meant to make it look a bit more like an SUV. And we've also got central locking, but in the form of it being keyless, which is good too. So you can just come up here and unlock and lock the car even from the boot without having to take the key out of your pocket. And around back, the Stonic looks most like an SUV, and that's thanks to the amount of ground clearance found underneath the car. And I also think this perennial gray, yes, that's what it's called, looks quite nice. It's very Audi-esque, like Audi's Nardo gray option. So it's quite a good color to have on a car like this. You've also got a bit of a roof spoiler. You do have a rear wiper, and below that you have a sporty diffuser. It's meant to be smoothing of the air and look a bit more aggressive, but the most egregious thing back here is just how fake these exhausts are. So unfortunately not fooling anyone, and they are very obviously trying to emulate exhaust, but they're not the real ones. The real one is underneath. Now the boot space and size is really the reason why you're looking at a Stonic over a hatchback, and you definitely get a bit more boot space with this having 352 liters of boot space with all the seats up. And that's nice and boxy and nice and deep, so you can get some suitcases, backpacks, whatever you need in there, and not have to worry about running out of space ever. It's not an awkward space, nice and square, easy to throw stuff in and out of. However, there is a pretty decent sized boot lip, which will make dragging items in and out just a little bit harder. However, that does give you a bit more boot floor depth, which just means you can put more items in there. If you fold the seats down, which fold in a 60-40 split, they'll give you 1,155 liters of boot space in total, which is plenty of space, and yes, you can most certainly go to IKEA using the Kia Stonic. I'm personally a really big fan of the Stonic's interior because it's simple, it's not trying to be anything too crazy, and it's really easy to use. First impressions, I thought, yeah, there's cheap materials and this does feel like an entry-level car, but in not really a bad way. It doesn't feel like I'm being punished for spending less money, which is something that Kia and Hyundai are getting really good at with the lower trims. There's an 8-inch touchscreen, which is really the focus of the cabin. It's angled towards you as the driver a little bit, and it is stuck up a tiny bit on the dash, but it's not too egregious there either. And it's really easy to use, really responsive, and really good for, say, putting maps up here, because this one comes with navigation. You can even use digital radio or even use it just as Bluetooth, and even has sounds of nature. Now, the center controls for the aircon are really easy to operate as well, and they don't look ugly either. They're nice and designed in with the cabin and going in with this tiger nose design, which is found all through Kia's cars and especially highlighted here, like the pattern on the seats. Below that, there's some places to connect your devices using a 12-volt or 180-watt socket and a USB and some shelving with some grip on it, so you can put your phone in there and have some extra storage space too. And this is the top of the range model, but we still have some blank buttons, probably from another model that had a bit more options. I love the steering wheel on the GT line, flat bottom, and it's trimmed in like a leather material. It feels really nice in the hand, and it just looks good too. In front of me, I have analog gauge, really easy to read and don't look ugly. They look nice, and there's a center screen in the middle for a digital speedometer and for your trip information. So it just makes it really easy to read all the vital information in your car, and you're never going to get confused about what your car is telling you. Now, this one has a sunroof, which you can see here is bringing a lot of light in, and I really recommend getting this if you're going to be planning on driving this around for a while, because it opens up this cabin quite a lot. Now, these seats are of a partial sort of leather material construction and cloth in the middle, and they have some nice highlighted stitching and also design in the seats. If you're taking this to carry some people around often, I think this is actually a really good back seat option for a small SUV. When I jump in, I'm 5'11". I feel like I have an okay amount of headroom, and that's because these thoughtfully carved out sections of the roof have been made for the rear occupants, because you can see the roof does sag down in front of me, and that's because they're just trying to make this a bit more roomy in the back. I have really sort of slim leg room. This is how I'd be sitting as a 5'11" driver. I have okay amounts of feet room. However, for smaller trips, which I imagine this is gonna be four or maybe like an hour or two, I'd be comfortable back here with four people in the car. Now for running costs, Kia offers a cap price servicing program for the 7 years or up to 70,000 kilometers of driving. And the total of that comes to $3,299 for the 7 years of servicing this, or up to 70,000 kilometers of driving. So that's pretty reasonable, but if you're doing lots and lots of kilometers, that might come up a lot quicker and it might cost you just a little bit more to own this over the course of the full 7 years. Now, if you're driving this day to day and you're wondering how much a full tank of gas will cost you in the Kia Stonic, a full tank of fuel will be around $65 to fill up this 45-liter tank. All right, so initial impressions of driving the Stonic, I was pretty comfortable. That is the main underlying thing that I've found while driving this car. I'm comfortable, I'm relaxed, I've got plenty of visibility, everything's at my fingertips in terms of infotainment and drive modes as well. I am just having a good, relaxed time driving this thing. There's no stress, there's no unnecessary noise, you have ample amounts of power to get off away from the lights and just cruise along. The whole thing is just very comfortable. So that is the first and foremost thing that I think this Stonic is really good at being, is being comfortable. Getting in and out is really easy as well, because you don't have to jump up or jump down into this car. It's nice and level with your hips if you're getting in and out. So it just means that you're not getting any of that back pain or anything like that, jumping in and out, if that's something you experience. So that's part of the appeal that I see driving around in this. Now, suspension is nice and spongy. It does take up a lot of the bumps and cracks in the road. However, these bigger 17-inch wheels certainly do feel like they are absorbing some of the impact over some jumps, like over a speed bump or anything like that. But it's not really noticeable, and really, it's just quite comfortable most of the time. Now, this is powered by a 1-liter three-cylinder turbocharged motor. It is producing only 74 kilowatts and 172 newton meters of torque. So it is not a very powerful power plant. However, you have to remember that this car only weighs just over 1.2 ton. So that's lighter than many other hatchbacks out on the market. So that power goes a lot further than you might think. However, it's still not gobs of power to dig into. It's just gonna be enough plus a little bit more, but not all that much more. It is still a sort of very smallly powered motor. It is not very engaging in terms of trying to get anything fast out of this thing. It is just gonna go where you need it to, and that is the main underlying proposition with this car, is that it's gonna get the job done. However, paired with this dual clutch transmission, the three-cylinder motor actually is quite a good motor with this setup. It's nice and smooth when it needs to be. However, this dual clutch transmission can't hide all the faults of being a dual clutch transmission, so it can be a little bit jerky at low speeds, say when you need to reverse or need to do small maneuvers with the accelerator pedal. However, that's really it when it's having its issues. Outside of that, it's really quite a good gearbox, and then this motor does power along quite nicely, and it can stay nice and low in the rev range and still give you enough power thanks to that turbocharger. So that's just something to keep in mind when you read those specs and go, ooh, that's not enough power. It really does translate to a really decent amount of power. And even cars with double the amount of kilowatts and newton meters that this car has still feel exactly the same as what this is like to drive, because just how light this car is. So something to note when you're looking at the specs on this car. If you want to dig down into that accelerator pedal and try and get some power out of that three cylinder, you do get a little bit of kick, but it's not going to be too much. So as a parent or someone who doesn't really like fast cars, you're never going to be stressed about having too much power to handle. It's enough, and that's really what it is. Now, we do have some drive modes in this car. We have Eco, which the car always starts in Eco, which really annoys me. That is really annoying, because I hate Eco modes. They just numb everything and dull the experience down and turn on the start-stop engine mode and all that sort of stuff. I really don't like that. So that is a big no-no when it comes to these drive modes. It always starts in Eco mode, no matter what mode you left it in last time. So then immediately what I do when I jump in the car is I put the drive mode into normal, and the car just becomes how I would expect it to perform and is quite comfortable in that mode. Now, there is a sport mode, but even someone like myself, an adrenaline junkie who loves driving fast cars and motorbikes, this sport mode, not really ever finding myself needing to engage this. It's a bit more responsiveness for the motor and gearbox, and does stiffen up the steering a bit more. But outside that, I know I'm still getting the same power output and the suspension isn't changing, so there's really no need to put it into sport mode. And even though this car will have you thinking that it is a bit sporty with this carbon fiber trim and flat bottom steering wheel, it really isn't all that sporty. So look, plenty of options here for the drive modes, but also it's a really just chill car to drive outside of needing to feel like you have to drive a sports car. And so the question remains, should you buy one of these? If you're looking for your first small SUV or your first car, or looking for one of these for the inner city living experience because you want a bit more boot space and a little bit more comfort because it sits a tiny bit higher up than a normal hatchback, then this is the car for you because it's cheap to run, looks pretty good, and is relatively comfortable on the inside. Now, if you're more of a fan of hatchbacks, you want to go off-road, you want something a bit more sporty with a bit more power, then unfortunately this isn't really the car for you because it's front wheel drive, it hasn't got all that much power, and it's also sitting a bit higher, so it certainly does look like a little SUV more so than a hatchback. So if those are the things that you really want, then this probably isn't for you, and I'd probably recommend checking out some other hatchbacks instead. Now, if you like this review, leave a comment and leave a like because I'll be replying to those comments because I always love having a chat down there. But if you loved it, please leave a subscription and make sure to go and hit that notification bell so you don't miss out on a single review coming out from us on every Friday. My name's Cameron. This is Product Review Cars. Thank you so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one.